Thank you all for coming. So my name is Bill Ariza. I'm the Vice Dean and a professor of law here at Brooklyn. We're delighted to have you. Thanks so much for attending this aspect or this phase of our Constitution Day observance. This phase of the observance will consist of a presentation by Professor A.E. Dick Howard, followed by a conversation between Professor Howard and two of my colleagues, Professor Susan Herman and Professor Bennett Capers. After that conversation, there'll be time for Q&A from the audience. After I introduce our speakers, I'll leave the podium and let them take over. Widely acknowledged as an expert in the fields of constitutional law, comparative constitutionalism, and the Supreme Court, A.E. Dick Howard is the White Burkett Miller Professor of Law and Public Policy at the University of Virginia. Born and raised in Richmond, Virginia, Professor Howard is a graduate of the University of Richmond and received his law degree at the University of Virginia. He was a Rhodes Scholar where he read at Oxford, where he read philosophy, politics, and economics. After graduating from law school, he was a law clerk for Justice Hugo Black of the United States Supreme Court. Active in public affairs, Professor Howard was executive director of the commission that wrote Virginia's current constitution, and he directed the successful referendum campaign to assure its ratification. Often consulted by constitutional draftspeople around the world, Professor Howard has worked on new constitutions in a number of countries, including Brazil, Hong Kong, the Philippines, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Poland, Romania, Russia, Albania, Malawi, and the Republic of South Africa. Professor Howard is the author of a number of books, articles, and monographs. And most relevantly for today's purposes, he's the author of two books on Magna Carta. First of all, Magna Carta, Text and Commentary, and also The Road from Runnymede, Magna Carta and Constitutionalism in America. In January 1994, Washingtonian magazine named Professor Howard one of the most respected educators in the nation. In 2007, the Richmond Times-Dispatch and the Library of Virginia named Professor Howard one of the greatest Virginians of the 20th century. In 2013, the University of Virginia recognized Professor Howard with its Thomas Jefferson Award, the highest honor given to faculty members at the university. The award commended Howard, quote, for advancing through his character, work, and personal example, the ideals and objectives for which Jefferson founded the university, unquote. We're very fortunate to have Professor Howard here today. We're also very fortunate to have two of my colleagues, Professor Herman and Professor Capers. I'll be a bit quicker introducing them since they're already well known to a number of you. Professor Susan Herman is a Centennial Professor of Law here at Brooklyn. She received her AB at Barnard and her JD from NYU. Professor Herman writes extensively on constitutional law and criminal procedure issues. She is also the president of the American Civil Liberties Union. Professor I. Bennett Capers is a Stanley A. August Professor of Law here at Brooklyn. He received his BA from Princeton and his JD from Columbia. Before joining the Brooklyn faculty, he was an assistant AUSA in the Southern District of New York, and he was a professor of law and associate dean for intellectual life at Hofstra Law School. Professor Capers writes extensively about the intersection of race, gender, and the criminal law. After Professor Howard presents his talk, Professors Herman and Capers will provide comments. In turn, there will be time for questions and answers from the audience. And with that, let me turn the podium over to Professor Howard.
Thank you. That was a very gracious introduction. You were kind enough to mention this award or that. You realize all those awards were simply stepping stones on the way to finally being allowed to speak at a platform at Brooklyn Law School. I mean, it's been years coming, but finally, and now I feel as if I've been recognized. I can go home and tell them I've been somewhere that really matters. 800 years of Magna Carta, you know, that's the occasion for our being here, that on June the 15th, 1215, at Runnymede, King John agreed reluctantly to the demands of his barons, and the result was what we today call Magna Carta. Well, that's 800 years ago. That's a long shelf life for anybody's document. That's a pretty impressive thing. But and you can understand why this year in the United Kingdom, why people are making a big thing of it. Every town that has any plausible connection with Magna Carta is having something to say about it. But the question that we ought to be posing, at least I would like to pose this afternoon, is why would we in America care about it? I mean, we don't have a king and we don't have barons, I don't think. Maybe we have barons in name and not in name, but at any rate, long time ago and pretty far from here, and so why should it matter to Americans? King John is very much a part of the story, and I first met King, well, actually, I didn't meet King John. Let me rephrase that. I didn't meet King. I was introduced to the idea or history of King John when I was a very small child through A.A. Milne. Many of you will know A.A. Milne as the creator of Winnie the Pooh and other wonderful childhood characters. And there's a wonderful book that he wrote called Now We Are Six. When I was a kid, my parents would read me from that book. And one of the poems in Now We Are Six is King John's Christmas. And it begins, if I remember it, something like, King John was not a good man. He had his many ways. And sometimes no one spoke to him for days and days and days. Well, you know, you're a little kid, and you read about somebody's being shunned. Nobody will talk to him. I mean, that's a big thing. And you say, nobody could be that bad. Well, I grew up and I read some more about King John, and he was that bad, if not worse. Certainly, he was certainly bad enough that no king of England has since that time been named King John. And I predict there will not be any John the Second. It's very, very unlikely. Somehow the name has been tainted. So here's a king who is not only in many ways perhaps morally corrupt, but also just an inept king. I mean, he managed to make all kinds of mistakes. He succeeded during his reign. I mean, I think one of the problems was he follows Richard the Lionheart. I mean, think about that. Your older brother is called Richard the Lionheart. Now, what are you going to grow up in the shadow of this guy? So Richard is one of the heroes of his time. He's off fighting crusades and becoming a symbol, and then King John succeeds him. And King John, as I say, ineptly and not having mastered statecraft, manages to lose most of the barons' land in Normandy. These are Normans. These are people that were landholders. And thanks to the Battle of Bouvines in 1214, John earns the name John Softsword, John Lackland, all sorts of epithets like that. So he blunders on the military front. He quarrels with the church over the appointment of the Archbishop of Canterbury. Finally, John has to acquiesce and yield on that point. He earns the enmity of citizens of London, but most importantly, he gets on the wrong side of the barons, because these foreign adventures are costing a lot of money. John needs money. He presses the barons in various ways, and so the barons finally, I won't give you the history lesson. I suspect you had that in the lecture earlier this morning, but basically it winds up that all these people are coalescing against John. It's really civil war. It's in fact civil war in the country, and John is finally obliged, in particular by the coalescence of the barons, to come to terms. He meets them at Runnymede, June of 1215. The document is produced that, as I say, today has the name Magna Carta. Actually, there's kind of a curious footnote to that. It wasn't called Magna Carta then. You know, we say Magna Carta, the Great Charter. It must be a big deal. Well, historically, in fact, it became Magna Carta because at one point they simply lifted out the Charter of the Forest provisions and created a separate, smaller document, the shorter document, and what was left was the bigger document, Magna Carta. Well, it was an accident of history, but it certainly earned its name. I'm going to spare you most of the details of Magna Carta. Most of it has to do with medieval feudal arrangements and the like, which I think are not part of the American story. And the one provision I'll single out is what in the 1215 charter was chapter 39. And that's the one that says no one shall be proceeded against except by the law of the land. Law of the land. And that phrase, as time passed within a century's time, the phrase law of the land became interchangeable with what we today call due process of law. So the American, when you read the 5th and 14th Amendments of the U.S. Constitution, and you read about due process of law, you're reading about a concept which traces organically all the way back to Magna Carta in 1215. Now, I won't go into the clumsy efforts to enforce the charter. They had did have a provision at the end that said if the king didn't keep his promises, the barons could have a committee of 25 who would lay siege to his castles and all that sort of thing. Well, it's perfectly clear that King John never meant to keep his promise. He was reluctantly agreeing to something he didn't want to do. And having finally come to terms with the Pope, he persuaded Innocent III to annul the charter. So within a few weeks' time, the charter was null and void. It was off the books. Well, that could have been the end of the story, except that King John died the next year. 1216, he dies. One of the chroniclers says that he died of a surfeit of peaches and new cider. And I know we're going to have dinner tonight, Mr. Dean, and if you offer me peaches and new cider, I think, if you don't mind, I may push my chair back. So I would say that, hope that's not on the menu. So King John dies. His successor is Henry III. He's 9 years old. Now, this is the Middle Ages. This is the 13th century. How long is a 9-year-old king going to live? I mean, have you seen Game of Thrones? You you know what I'm talking about. So Henry III's advisors, William Marshall, the regent, and others, hit upon what I think we would call a good public relations gambit. They said, let's have the king reissue Magna Carta. Now, it was tweaked a little bit. It wasn't exactly the 1215 charter, but they said, let's sort of buy some goodwill by having Magna Carta reissued, which was done. And then finally, when Henry III attained his majority, the charter was reissued again. And that began a long tradition succession that as monarchs came to the throne, they would recognize Magna Carta. Now, there's one other comment to make before I pass from that period, and that is there was in the reign of Edward III a statute that said if statutes were contrary to Magna Carta, they would be null and void. Now, that's a bit of a conundrum because one statute can't really, I mean, it can supersede another, but Parliament could always then pass a third statute, right, changing the law again. I suspect what that was really about was, in effect, a canon of construction for judges that if they had a case with a statute here and Magna Carta there, they would prefer Magna Carta. But whatever it meant at the time, it certainly begins to plant the notion that Magna Carta is no ordinary statute. This is something different, something special, and that really is part of my story. Well, I'm going to pass over the Tudor period. I assume you've seen Wolf Hall, and you know that I suppose it's fair to say that the reign of Henry VIII was not thought of as a great reign of constitutional government. And so I'm going to pass that one by. Brings us to the 17th century. Now we're on the edge of American colonization. I mean, the 17th century in England, it must have been a dreadful time for most people. I mean, it was a very turbulent century, a century of civil war, a century that saw the execution of Charles I. It saw changes of regime, the Cromwellian regime and others. The Civil War in England was, I think, in many ways as bad as the Civil War in this country, not fought on the same scale, but still a war of brother against brother. So it was, for our purposes, a time of constitutional reinterpretation. It began for this account with Elizabeth being succeeded by James VI of Scotland comes to the throne of England as James I. And he brings with him the notion of divine right of kings. And this is a recipe for trouble because like all kings, he needed money. And he's leaning on his people for various impositions and forced loans and the like. And this begins to reach the point where after James's time, Charles I comes to the throne, matters get even worse. I think one of the problems must have been that the Stuarts, the kings of England, thought they ought to have the same sort of lifestyle as the monarchs of the continent, the Sun King at Versailles and that sort of thing. They had court favorites. This was expensive. They needed money, and therefore problems of getting that money out of Parliament. 1628, it came to a head with the famous Petition of Right, one of the important liberty documents in English constitutional history. And the key figure in that particular debate was Sir Edmund Coke, spelled C-O-K-E, but pronounced Coke. We Americans would have said Coke, but you know, it's their guy, so they could call him what they like. So Lord Coke, he's the one who is Attorney General at one point, President of Court of King's Bench, and the Parliament, also a commentator on Magna Carta. And he, in Parliament, he's a leader of the parliamentary opposition to the pretensions of the Stuart King. And he said famously, Magna Carta is such a fellow, he will have no sovereign. So this suggests that Coke took the lead in effect rediscovering or certainly reemphasizing Magna Carta as one of the parts of the inheritance, ancient rights of the English people. Well, Petition of Right didn't settle things. Struggles continued. Civil War broke out in 1642. It was on and off, and finally, many of you know this story, Parliament tried Charles I for treason, and he was executed in 1649. Oliver Cromwell succeeds. The Cromwellian regime comes to power for a relatively short time until 1660 with the restoration of the Stuarts. Now, in the Stuart period, when the Stuarts are back on the throne, Charles II, probably most known to many of us as the Merry Monarch, known for his mistress, Nell Gwynn. I mean, he had Catholic notions about bringing England back into the Catholic circle of affairs, but he was a little more politic than his successor, James II. James II came to the throne 1685, and he actually set about devices that would, if they had been successful, have put Catholic judges on the bench, Catholics perhaps in control of Parliament and the like. And of course, again, this is the 17th century when religion was a very powerfully vicious matter on both sides. In the continent of Europe, you get the 30 Years' War, thought largely about religious matters. So finally, Protestants in England were concerned about where James II was taking the country. They oust him and bring William and Mary to the throne. So I've capsuled a lot of history there, but I suspect many of you are familiar with it. The royal army sort of melted away. William and Mary come to the throne in what Whig historians used to call the Glorious Revolution. I don't know if that's politically correct to call it what's so glorious if you were on the losing side of it. But 1689, you get William and Mary on the throne and the English Bill of Rights. I want to mention that document because that's so much a part of the story of how you get from Magna Carta to American constitutionalism. And it's the English Bill of Rights. So it's a very short document. If you go online sometime and just read it, it's pretty short, and you will find, even if you only have a glancing knowledge of American constitutional law, you will find some pretty familiar provisions in there, provisions which word for word have carried over into the American Constitution or into the American Bill of Rights. Things like free speech in Parliament, the right not to be questioned in any other place, provisions about cruel and unusual punishment and the like. So it's a part of this distillation of English ideas which became part of American constitutional law. Now, okay, that's in nutshell form the English side of the story. Now, the part I really want to get to this afternoon is what happens when you cross the Atlantic? Now, that same 17th century that I've just described in England is also the century in which all of the original American English-speaking colonies were planted, except I think Georgia, which I think was 1701, but the rest of them pretty much in the 17th century, beginning with Virginia in 1607, Massachusetts in 1620, and so forth. I was just in Boston last fall giving something called the James Otis Lecture, and I discovered that my friends in Massachusetts are very good at words, maybe not so good at numbers. They somehow don't realize that 1607 is a lower number than 1620. And so I didn't make a lot of friends up there by pointing that out, but that's what having tenure at a university is all about. They're not going to fire you because you make enemies in some other part of the country. Well, say that's the English. Now, on the American side, I think that the critical point is the colonial charters. The Virginia Company Charter of 1606, mostly a commercial charter. People thought they were going to get rich. They were going to find gold and silver in Virginia. I don't think you've heard a lot about gold and silver being found in Virginia. They thought they would do it. Somebody discovered tobacco, and that's how they got rich. The most interesting provision in that Virginia charter is one that guarantees that if you were pulling up your roots in England and coming to America as a colonist, you would enjoy the privileges, franchises, and immunities that you would have enjoyed in the mother country. In other words, you didn't leave your rights behind, you brought them with them. Now, one may fairly debate what the substantive content of that language was, but you get the general picture. You've got common law protections, and they come to America with you. That provision was then repeated in the other colonial charters, then reinforced by provisions that said that colonial legislatures couldn't pass ordinances inconsistent with English law. There were provisions for the laws that were passed to be sent back over to England to be reviewed by the Privy Council or the Board of Trade to see if they were consistent. There were provisions for the appeal of cases worth a certain amount of money could be appealed to London and the like. So there was, in so many ways, this constant re-infusion, constant reiteration that English law was the standard by which American legal arrangements would be governed. There were other incidents, some interesting occasions when colonists were asserting specifically the rights of Magna Carta. For example, in Massachusetts in the 17th century, under a theocratic form of government, there were some dissenters who objected that they were not actually enjoying the rights of Magna Carta. So they filed a petition with the magistrates of the colony, and they in turn, they probably wished these people just go away and not bother them, but they felt obliged to reply in something that history has called the Parallels of Massachusetts. And in that document, in one column are the provisions of Magna Carta, in the other column are provisions of Massachusetts law, probably special pleading. I think it was like a lawyer's brief. They put the best face on it. But I think the important thing is that the magistrates felt compelled to reply to the charge, to say, yes, you do enjoy the rights of Magna Carta, and we're not taking those away from you. Well, that was the 17th century. You pass on into the age of the American Revolution, then the picture really begins to coalesce. I mentioned James Otis. In 1760, he argued in a Boston courtroom the famous writs of assistance case. Now, writs of assistance were like general search warrants, basically not describing a particular place or thing to be looked for, but just kind of a blank check. Go in and look for anything you like. And they were meant to enforce customs dues in particular. And Otis argued that these writs of assistance were, in our modern sense of the word, unconstitutional. Now, this is a pretty remarkable argument to be making. There was, in the first place, no written constitution in Britain. And his argument wouldn't have been understood or accepted in an English courtroom at that time. But Otis cited as support for his proposition Lord Cook, the same Cook that resisted the Stuarts in the early 17th century. Cook had decided a case in 1610 called Dr. Bonham's case. And in it, he said, an act of Parliament that's against right reason is null and void. Now, historians have debated, was that a whole, it's probably dictum. It's not perfectly clear where Cook was taking it, but it's a pretty powerful statement that even Parliament can't do what it pleases. Now, when Otis was making that argument in Boston in 1760, on the other side of the Atlantic, William Blackstone was about to produce his commentaries on the English laws, and In that commentary, Blackstone says, Parliament calls the shots. Parliament is supreme. There is no authority I know of that can control Parliament. So at this moment, you have one of the critical departures in Anglo-American history. Namely, here's Otis and Americans on one side of the Atlantic saying there are principles that control Parliament. And then on the other side of the Atlantic, you have Blackstone and the British government saying, no, Parliament is sovereign. Now, these are two worlds. No wonder as the revolution began to take shape that the English and Americans were talking past each other. They simply had two opposing conceptions of what the British Constitution is. As a side note, I might mention, as you know, the United Kingdom is one of the small handfuls of countries that still has no written constitution. In theory, at least, Parliament is supreme. They've tried to bridge that gap a little bit with something called the Human Rights Act of 1998, which gives English judges the power to declare acts of Parliament incompatible with the European Convention on Human Rights. And that's sort of a halfway station between judicial review American style and just pure and simple parliamentary sovereignty. So that's the stage that is set for the American Revolution. Familiar history to all of you Americans who have studied this revolutionary period. The Stamp Act provokes a striking ardent resistance on the part of Americans. It was the first time that Parliament had passed an act imposing internal taxes as opposed to customs duties and the like in America. The colonists were outraged. They said no taxation without consent, familiar charge. And they also objected to the fact that these customs cases were being tried in admiralty courts in which you had no jury. Boston Tea Party comes along and they throw tea into the Boston Harbor, and that produces a round of parliamentary acts closing the port of Boston, dissolving the local assembly, quartering troops on the populace in Boston and the like. And when that happened, then all the other colonies rallied to the support of Massachusetts. And they came together in the Continental Congress. And in 1774, this is 2 years before the revolution, before independence, a set of resolutions was drafted proclaiming the Americans' case against British policy. And the debates are interesting to me because they were searching for the basis on which to stake American rights. How would you frame those rights? Where do they come from? Well, some of the delegates at Philadelphia said they're natural law. They're natural rights. They're God-given rights. They're just inherent in the human condition. Others were a bit more lawyerly. They said, well, we need a legal source. We can look at these colonial charters like the Virginia Company Charter. Or, in particular, some said we look at Magna Carta. We look at the British Constitution. So you had a theoretical debate over how to articulate American rights. And in typically American fashion, they put them all into one package. They said, well, we don't really have to agree on just any one source. We will agree to put them all in the resolution as if to say it doesn't matter what label you put on it. Call them natural rights, call them British Constitution, charter rights, whatever. It all adds up to the same thing. That we Americans have rights and you British are denying, not recognizing those rights. Well, I think those of you who are lawyers and have studied American constitutional law in the first year in law school, remember how messy it was? It was never very tidy. You know, French constitutional law is very neat and analytical. And American constitutional law is not like that. And I think one reason for it is the story I'm telling here, that we've been willing to just bring disparate ideas together into one package. So revolution comes, independence is declared, and I think it's quite magical that on the day that the Virginia delegates at Williamsburg, the same group that instructed Virginia's delegates at Philadelphia to declare independence, on the same day those Virginians set to work on a Constitution for Virginia. Now, in fact, they've set to work on two documents, not one. First, a Declaration of Rights. This is the influence of John Locke in the Social Compact. Namely, you declare your rights, the inherent rights that do not depend on government. They precede government. Having done that, then the Virginians moved on to write a frame of government, or what we would call a constitution. I think that two-step process was conscious and I think very important. And in those early state constitutions, Virginia, Pennsylvania, Massachusetts, and so forth, there was a blend of Locke and social compact and natural rights with provisions drawn directly from Magna Carta, English Petition of Rights, English Bill of Rights, all brought together in a single document. Now, one of the people who was unhappy about that first Virginia Constitution was the founder of my university, Thomas Jefferson. And I've always had the notion that maybe one reason he didn't like it was because he wasn't there. And Thomas Jefferson couldn't imagine you could do anything without him, right? He was the indispensable man. So he, for the next 50 years, he complained about that first Virginia Constitution. And his fundamental objection was that the same body that had was drafting ordinary laws had drafted a constitution. And that confuses two functions. You can't have lawmaking and constitution making confused with each other, because it means the constitution is just another law. It's not superior law. So here is where I'm a provincial Virginian. I confess I've already made that clear. I have to give credit to my friends in Massachusetts for doing what we had not done in Virginia, and that was in 1780, when Massachusetts adopted its first state constitution, they called a convention. It was the people in the western part of the state in the Berkshires who were concerned that the potentates in Boston were going to kind of call all the shots, and they insisted on a convention elected by the people to write a constitution. The work there was done largely by Samuel Bowdoin, John Adams, Samuel Adams. As a subcommittee, the three of them gave all the work to John Adams. I think Samuel went off to the nearest tavern, and John was the workhorse in the family. And being John Adams, he said, sure, I can write you a constitution. No problem. Go into a tavern down here sometime and ask for a John Adams beer. Bartender will look at you with a blank, what? I don't even know what you're talking about. Ask for Samuel Adams beer, and you'll get one. So John writes a constitution. John Adams was not a modest man, and he would like to have had people think that that was the model for the federal constitution. Well, that's part of the story. So Massachusetts writes a constitution, and the people then vote on it. So at that point, Americans have created something that Europe never had. And that was the notion of the Constitutional Convention over and above, separate from the ordinary legislative process. And in that Massachusetts document, again, there's an interesting mixture of ideas. It starts out by talking about how it's a social compact, but also that it's a covenant. And that's the language of theology. And you find in Massachusetts they're blending the secular idea of compact and the theological idea of covenant. If you want to understand why Northerners in the Civil War thought they were undertaking a sacred cause, the battle hymn of the Republic, all that, it's partly because Northerners' views of the American Constitution brought them to see we the people as enacting a sacred covenant, not simply a secular compact. Well, the federal Constitution then is drafted 1787, and this is interesting. I am not aware that Magna Carta was ever mentioned at the Philadelphia Convention. Now, we don't have a full transcript of the debates. We have Madison's notes, and that may have been 10% of what was said. But as far as I know, no one ever talked about Magna Carta. Well, assuming my story has any cogency that Magna Carta mattered in American history, why did it not become part of the conversation at Philadelphia? I think, assuming that's correct, I think the reason may have been the Federalists wanted people to understand that Magna Carta was, as they saw it, a grant from the king, whereas the Constitution was based on popular sovereignty. It was an act of we the people. Further, I think Magna Carta was a limit on royal power, a limit on the executive, whereas the Constitution meant to limit all the branches of government, legislative, executive, and judicial. So what, and Madison thought, went along with all of that. Well, whatever their reasoning at Philadelphia, the Federalists made a near-fatal mistake. They failed to add a Bill of Rights. There was a motion on the floor rejected by the convention to have a Bill of Rights, and Madison didn't think one was necessary. He even thought it might be dangerous because it might imply the non-existence of rights not listed in the Bill of Rights. Well, Jefferson brought him around on that. And in the ratification debates, it was a close call. I mean, I think the Constitution was ratified by 10 votes in Virginia, by 6 votes in New York. I mean, a handful of votes could have dashed all hopes for a new Constitution. I mean, if New York and Virginia had voted no at that point, hard to imagine they would have gone back to the drafting table. So in the ratification debates, the chief argument, one of the chief arguments anti-Federalists were making was, where's the Bill of Rights? And so Madison and the Federalists said, okay, we get the point. Just ratify the Constitution, and at the first Congress, we will propose amendments to the Constitution, and that is, he was as good as his word, and that's how we came up with the Bill of Rights we now have. So this is a story altogether of a blend of innovation on the one hand, judicial review, federalism, and the like being American contributions, and tradition on the other, in particular the traditions that flow from Magna Carta. So how would I sum up what Magna Carta has come to mean in terms of American law and constitutionalism? I think the most obvious contribution would be the one you hear a lot about, and that is Magna Carta being the iconic representation of what we like to call the rule of law, the notion of the rule of law, the notion that no man, including the king, no person, no one, even the monarch, is above the law. Lawyers like myself tend to take that phrase rule of law for granted. I remember being in what was then Leningrad, now St. Petersburg, when they were working on the first post-Soviet constitution. Do you remember those days when we thought that Russia might actually become a part of the family of liberal constitutional democracies? In the age of Putin, it seems a long time ago, but we were at the table. I was working with lawyers and judges. I don't speak any Russian, so we were working through an interpreter. And I discovered, she was very good, she was doing a wonderful job, but I discovered at one point she was translating the English phrase rule of law as socialist legality. Well, I had to say, well, actually that's not quite what we mean when we use the phrase rule of law. Secondly, I think Magna Carta is part of this ongoing Anglo-American tradition of the articulation of fundamental rights. And in this country, I mean, I've traveled to some other countries, and there is no country on earth which is more rights conscious, more prepared to take a garden variety dispute and turn it into an argument about the Constitution than we are. I mean, I sometimes think our national motto ought to be, I'll see you in court. Because we love to go, we complain about lawyers all the time, but boy, we're the first people to go to court. And we frame it in terms of rights, and that's Magna Carta, Petitioner Right, English Bill of Rights, American Bill of Rights, right down to the present time. Thirdly, I think the idea of a written constitution, the notion of writing it down, is a very Anglo-American thing. This is partly historical, partly biblical, if you like, whatever the causes of it. We like documents which sum up our fundamental principles, and I think Magna Carta is such a good example of that. I was giving lectures earlier during the summer in England, going around Salisbury Cathedral, British Library, other places, and in the Q&A sessions, the question that tended to come up the most often was, should the United Kingdom have a written constitution? Well, I mean, I had to say, look, I'm an American visitor. I didn't come here to advise you. But then I said, but on the other hand, if you do want to write one, I'm glad to lend a hand. Fourthly, in the Magna Carta tradition or legacy in this country, I think it really is a key part of the movement towards what we now think of as constitutional supremacy. The notion that the Constitution is superior to and trumps negates inconsistent legislation. Remember that statute that I mentioned from the reign of Edward III? Recall Lord Coke's decision in Dr. Bonham's case, remember James Otis's argument in Boston, 1760, the idea that constitutions are superior to ordinary law was well implanted by the time of the American Revolution and by the time we wrote our first constitutions. Again, those of you who have studied law, I'm sure remember in the first year reading John Marshall's opinion in Marbury versus Madison. And I remember the first time I read it, I was struck by the fact that he starts out by talking about general principles of jurisprudence. What do you mean by the whole idea of a constitution is it's meant to be superior to ordinary law. And then later on towards the end of the opinion, almost as if it were an afterthought, he says, oh yes, and by the way, there's the supremacy clause of the Constitution. You know, today we would start with the text and go from there, but Marshall was saying, look, this is so fundamental. The supremacy clause is just stating the obvious. Well, I think that's part of the mindset of Marshall's generation and one way of thinking about how, as we built on these English roots, we were on the road to constitutional supremacy. And then finally, Magna Carta is very much part of the story of organic, unfolding, evolving constitutional principles. Think about, Justice Scalia is not in the room, is he, Nick? I don't want to start a fist fight here, but it is part of the story of what we call the living Constitution. Now, I realize there are textualist originalists who think that's a bad idea. It may be a bad idea or good, but it is a fact. This is the way American constitutional law has evolved. Now, think, for example, about Supreme Court opinions involving cruel and unusual punishment. It is manifestly clear that the Supreme Court doesn't see that as frozen in time in 1791. Indeed, they will overrule fairly modern cases. There were two 1989 cases in which the court said that it was cruel and unusual to use the death penalty for youthful offenders in one case or the somewhat mentally retarded in another case, 1989. And then in 2002 and 2005, they overruled those respective opinions less than 20 years later. That shows you the sort of living Constitution idea. I mentioned due process of law. If you know, as many of you do, the story of due process of law, think of how it's evolved over the centuries from whatever it may have meant in the minds of the founders through the Fifth and Fourteenth Amendments. Privacy and autonomy, family rights, parental rights, all just so many examples of it. And one of the very striking modern examples is language used by Justice Kennedy. This was in Lawrence versus Texas in 2003. And that's the case involving gay rights striking down a Texas anti-sodomy law. He said, those who drew and ratified the Due Process Clause did not presume to know the components of liberty and its manifold possibilities. The times can blind us to certain truths, and later generations can see that laws once thought necessary and proper serve only to oppress. As the Constitution endures, persons in every generation can invoke its principles in their own search for greater freedom. Now that is a statement, that's the living Constitution notion. That's 2003. If you've read Kennedy's majority opinion in this year's Obergefell decision, the same-sex marriage case, at the very end of his opinion, he uses almost word for word this same language. And I was intrigued by the fact he didn't put it in quotes and quote his own opinion from 2003. He simply wrote it as text, as if this were, again, one of those self-evident propositions that didn't need a cite. Didn't need a source, even though he would have been citing himself. Now, obviously, as you know, that divides the court. There are those on the other side of that proposition. But think of the power of how much that idea has achieved in terms of American constitutional law. Now, one last thought, and that is a word about the charter itself. I started with the 1215 charter. There are 17 extant copies of Magna Carta from the 1215 charter to 1297 when it went on the statute books of England. Of those 17, all of them are in England except for two. One is in Australia and one is in this country. The four 1215 charters are all in England, two at the British Library, one at Salisbury Cathedral, one at Lincoln Cathedral. I was on a plane one time flying to London. My seatmate, by chance, happened to be a lawyer from Texas. He was Ross Perot's personal lawyer. He told me the story of how Ross Perot, a man of some means, as you know, I guess Ross Perot had everything else, he decided he would like to have a copy of Magna Carta. And he heard that there was a family, and this is a 1297 copy. He heard this family in England had this charter, so he sends this lawyer over to bargain for it, and the lawyer bargained for $1.5 million back in the 1980s. Not an insubstantial price to pay. So I asked this chap, my seatmate, I said, okay, so you buy this copy of Magna Carta. Doesn't England have laws about exporting its patrimony? You know, it's an important document. I said, how'd you get it home? He said, well, first I rolled it up and put it in a mailing tube. I was thinking, this priceless document, you put it in a mailing tube. And I said, okay, fine. You get to Heathrow Airport, what do? He says, well, the customs agent asked me what I had in the tube. And I said, well, I have a copy of Magna Carta. And they say, right, mate, go on through. So, you know, thinking, I suppose, it was a facsimile of Magna Carta, copy in that sense. Well, they get it home. It went on display in the National Archives. Well, some years passed. And I guess Ross Perot decided at some point he didn't really need that copy of Magna Carta anymore, so he put it on auction in New York at Sotheby's. And another man of substantial means, David Rubenstein, hears about the auction. So he sends someone up over the phone. He makes his bid for Magna Carta and pays $21.5 million. So now you know how Ross Perot has a lot of money, right? That's a pretty good profit from 1.5 in the 80s to 21.5 in fairly recently. So 21.5. So the National Archives called me and said they were going to put this document on display at the archives, and would I come up and give a lecture? I said, sure, I'll be happy to give a lecture. So each week, the week before, I think it's Thursday of each week in the Washington Post, they've got a little box. And it mentions two or three things that you might find interesting the following week. And the week before my lecture, it said something like, Professor A.E. Dick Howard of the University of Virginia on Tuesday, March the 10th at 7:30 p.m. at the National Archives will appear to talk about his book, The Road from Runnymede, and his purchase of a copy of Magna Carta for $21.5 million. Well, I went home that night to my wife, Mary, and I said, Mary, we're going to start getting some really interesting phone calls. A lot of interesting invitations to some very fancy dinners, and like I said, don't ask any questions. Just accept. Well, it came and went. We didn't get a lot of invitations. I'm sure the readers of the Post were swift enough to know that a law professor is not going to lay down that kind of change for a copy of Magna Carta. So that's the copy when you go to the National Archives. It's sort of like going into a cathedral, you know, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, Bill of Rights, and over in the side, this copy of Magna Carta. So there you have basically the story of Magna Carta in America. I mean, we don't live in feudal times. We don't have a monarch. We don't have the problems that the barons were dealing with. But I think that Magna Carta really remains at the core of the American search to try to resolve questions, the premises of ordered liberty in our own time. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Telling Lloyd I don't have a PowerPoint, I only have my words. So, I think Constitution Day is the perfect day to be celebrating our connections with Magna Carta and our traditions that we can trace back to Magna Carta of liberty and due process and rights and law of the land. And Professor Howard has just done an excellent job of explaining how the Magna Carta came to America and how it evolved into a lot of the rights that we know today. One of the things that I did in preparation for today was I typed Magna Carta into the search box on the ACLU website, and I got 52 hits, showing that quite recently ACLU lawyers have cited Magna Carta in briefs arguing about things like illegal detention of suspected terrorists and immigrants, quite recently in a case about the American government killing by a drone, an American citizen who had not had any due process, freedom of religion, search and seizure. So there are all sorts of ways in which the Magna Carta continues to evolve and to inform the development of American law. But since you've already heard that part of the story, our debt to Magna Carta and our traditions of freedom and liberty, I thought at the end of the day, it might be interesting to talk about some of the things that are not in the American Constitution, which I think we may trace our not having these things in the Constitution to our Magna Carta traditions. And I'd be really interested to know whether Professor Howard thinks that there were seeds that could have evolved in different ways and what the Americans made of it. So I want to talk briefly about three different concepts which appear elsewhere in the world, either in founding documents or just in their statements of fundamental values: equality, affirmative obligations of the government, and fraternity. First, on the subject of equality, as you've already heard today, Magna Carta was a deal between the barons and the king, and originally it guaranteed rights to free men. There are a couple of different words there. There's the free and the men. And if you were here this morning, you heard Derek Taylor estimate that uncovered by all these wonderful rights in Magna Carta was 85% of the population. The women, although I gather that may be arguable in terms of the language, the serfs, the unfree labor. So from the very beginning, Magna Carta kind of gave the Americans a template for how you could have a wonderful statement of principles: all men are created equal, they are endowed by their creator, and at the same time, publish a document that tolerated slavery and that did not give rights to everybody. Now, I think that the framers of our Constitution are not quite as dissimilar from those barons as we might like to think. In Jonathan Askin's phrase, they were all white men from the Northeast, more or less, and they were also men of property. And a lot of our Constitution is infused with, Charles Beard talks about their self-interest, their own protection of their own property, their own rights. As with Magna Carta, there's a lot of trickle down from their rights to the rights of everybody else. So the due process story, I think, is a very great story of success. But there are two kinds of equality that are involved that didn't make their way into our 18th century Constitution. One was the idea of everybody really being equal under law, because there were so many people who were not. The slaves clearly were not the Native Americans. I read an estimate once that the people who were the ratifiers of the Constitution, the people who could vote, were 1/6 of the adult population, because the states set voting requirements, and not only did you have to be a man, but you had to own property, and it was really a very limited part of the populace that was involved in being we the people. So one part of evolution that we saw over time was with the idea of equal justice for all, everybody participating, everybody having a role, come into the American Constitution. And as you all know, it took us a very bloody civil war to get that to happen. So it wasn't until the 14th Amendment, after the Civil War took place, that the Constitution added not only a due process clause, but a requirement that the states must guarantee equal protection of the laws to all persons. That's one idea, that we have to be treated equally by the government. A second idea of equality is one that also did not start until after the 14th Amendment in this country, and that's the idea not just of who gets to participate in the government and share in rights, but the idea of equality that we shouldn't have discrimination by the government against certain people or groups of people. So, for example, for a long time, the states could tell women that they couldn't serve as jurors, where they couldn't be lawyers. That was even upheld by the Supreme Court in the 19th century. So these ideas of equality were just not part of the original Constitution. After the 14th Amendment, we started developing ideas of equality that I think we're still really struggling with. Whose country is this? Who gets to participate, and what do we mean by equality? So I'm not being judgmental about those barons or the archbishop to say that this just wasn't on their screen. They lived in a world where people were serfs, and that was just the way it was, and women were not quite people, or certainly not people with any political rights. So one question is, given that Magna Carta has had more of an effect, as Professor Howard says, in this country than in England, Had we not had a civil war, was it possible that that idea of due process could have evolved into principles of equality? There are a couple of connections that I want to mention in terms of connections between equality and due process, as opposed to needing a separate guarantee of equality. One is the Warren Court's criminal procedure revolution, where without really relying on the Equal Protection Clause, the court uses due process and the particular liberties like right to jury trial, right to counsel, in order to try to create more equal proceedings, mostly targeting black defendants in the South. So a connection between due process and equality that perhaps might have evolved naturally. A second is one of the very peculiar anomalies of constitutional interpretation. A case some of you may know called Bolling versus Sharp. This was a companion case to Brown versus Board of Education. Brown versus Board of Education, as you know, said that under the Equal Protection Clause, the states were not permitted to deny equal protection by segregating their schools. Now, the problem that came up in Bolling versus Sharp was that the schools in the District of Columbia were not run by a state. They were run by Congress. And so you look at the words of the 14th Amendment, and the 14th Amendment says states can't deny people equal protection, and it doesn't say the federal government. Our original 18th century Constitution had no guarantee of equality. So the very interesting, I think necessary and appropriate, but very peculiar move the Supreme Court made was they said, oh, well, there actually is a guarantee of equality in the original Constitution. It's in the Due Process Clause. And ever since then, any equal protection claim that anyone wants to bring against the federal government, they bring under the Fifth Amendment Due Process Clause. Okay, so this, I think, is, you know, hindsight, looking back and seeing that the Due Process Clause perhaps could include a guarantee of equality. So that's my first question about the connection between due process and equality. Can you evolve there, or do you have to have a civil war and amend the Constitution by putting in an equality guarantee to start paying attention to whether there really is equal justice for all and whether there's an opportunity to have an anti-discrimination provision that says the government has to treat everybody equally, even if it's just a matter of the government hiring people, et cetera. Second, the idea of affirmative obligations. One thing that you learn in constitutional law is that almost everything that the Constitution says is negative. They're all restrictions on the government. What you've heard about all day, what the government can't do. The government can't tell you what religion to believe in, what to say. The government can't lock you up without giving you due process. Does the government have any affirmative obligations? Well, until the Warren Court, the answer was pretty much no. The Warren Court found in the 1960s, one example again of, you know, kind of serving equality, they found that the Sixth Amendment right to counsel should be interpreted to guarantee that the government would have to give you a lawyer who they would pay for if they were charging you with a crime and you were too poor to afford a lawyer of your own. Okay? Guaranteed right of counsel for indigents. There are a couple of other places where there are affirmative obligations of the government, but they're very narrow and very contingent. Government doesn't have to do a thing for you. If they charge you with a crime, if they lock you up in prison, they have to feed you. So the affirmative obligations don't go very deep. Reed Hunt mentioned before the four freedoms, and some of you may know that President Roosevelt used to say that the four freedoms were the next frontier for our Constitution, that that's the next thing that American society should have evolved to accept as our foundational values. The chief difference between the four freedoms, the one that is really not covered within our original Constitution, is freedom from want. There is nothing in our Constitution, certainly not the 18th century Constitution, that provides for any socioeconomic rights or imposes any obligation on the government to help people who are hungry eat, to find housing for people who don't have housing, to rescue refugees who are drowning at sea. Government doesn't have an obligation to do anything. Could that be done otherwise? Well, as Professor Howard very well knows, the South African Constitution, which was adopted in 1996, rejected the American constitutional model on that basis and does include socioeconomic rights. So that's another question of, you know, is it the Magna Carta libertarian tradition that leads us to conceive of a constitution as limiting government as opposed to imposing obligations on government? And is that something that could have developed otherwise? Is it Magna Carta's influence that causes us to think that a constitution should be negative? Or, you know, could it have happened some other way? Finally, fraternity. Here I'm thinking about the French triumvirate of values, liberty, equality, and fraternity. I won't say it in French. But this is not embodied in a written constitution, but those are the French values, liberty and equality. Well, we're very good at liberty, and I've just talked about equality. We said we're a late starter there, and we're still working on it. But there is nothing in our constitution like the French concept of fraternity, that community has its own rights, and that its own rights might sometimes trump our rights. So I'll give you an example of what I mean. I was at a conference this summer where one of the people attending was a young woman who was on the staff of Charlie Hebdo. Now, I don't need to tell you that she was quite devastated by the fact that she had lost a number of her friends and colleagues in the recent attack on Charlie Hebdo because they had been printing anti-Muslim cartoons. She was justifying Charlie Hebdo's publishing of these cartoons, the sort of, you know, being very offensive to Muhammad, making fun of the Muslim religion. And she justified it not the way an American would, on libertarian grounds, that you have a right. She justified it because she said that religion is divisive, and that in France, your primary obligation is to be a member of the community, is to be French. And so if you go out in the public square, you can't wear a burqa, because then you're not being French. You're putting your own idea of religion above the values of your community, and that is just wrong. Okay, so that's clearly just not an American idea. That's one that we just don't accept. We would never say that what your community thinks, and certainly the ACLU would not say this, that what your community would expect from you, that you should conform, is something that you should do. But when I've been in situations talking to people in Europe and around the world, they always ask me, well, what do you think about this French idea of laïcité? You know, what about that? You know, shouldn't there be a right in the public square for everybody to be equal and to not have some individuals standing out because of how they want to, you know, celebrate their own religion? That's a place where we just didn't go. I don't think we ever would have gotten there. But it's another thing that is not part of our basic values in contrast to France. The other thing I want to tell you actually about this young woman from Charlie Hebdo, because it again, I think, tells you about enormous cultural differences in terms of what are your fundamental values. I asked her my sort of ACLU question, well, you know, are you saying that there can't be any censorship? You know, what if you had published a cartoon that was racist? Would that be okay? And she said, oh, well, no, of course that would be terrible. You can't do that. She said, of course there are laws against that. Of course you can't do that. That's offensive. That's personal. That's horrible. So, you know, not a distinction that is meaningful under American constitutional law. You can be offensive about religion, but not about race. Totally different. So I think I just wanted to pose these questions to Professor Howard. I think Professor Capers is going to have some things to say and questions to ask that, you know, fit right in. And perhaps they'll be interesting to some of you, that at the end of the day, just wanting to open out the conversation to not only talk about what Magna Carta did for American culture and the values that it contributed and that we built on, but perhaps also how it steered us in a direction that was a choice because of what we didn't do. Thank you.
So, Professor Howard, I could either let you answer or address Professor Herman's questions, or I could ask you a series of questions. Mine are much more disjointed, so it's up to you.
Do you think there's overlap between yours and hers? Because I'll be happy to do either way.
I'm not sure there's overlap. Okay. So,
well, while they're fresh, this is actually a part of a personal plot between Dean Allard and myself that this is going to be the first of several Howard lectures at the Brooklyn Law School. You've now heard the outline for three further lectures that I'll be giving on future occasions. You'll be getting email notices of my full-blown response to each of these. These are Brooklyn Law School professors must sit around and think up all these. If I were a student in her class, I'd be terrified. You know, but if she'd hit me with questions like that, these are profound and wonderful questions. I love all of them. So let me try it succinctly to make a comment on each of the three. I love these questions. First, on the principle of equality, actually, it's very remote. It would be genealogically hard to say that our equal protection clause flows from Magna Carta. That would be a stretch. But there were provisions in Magna Carta which do have the sense of equality. For example, Chapter 40 of the 1215 Charter said that justice shall not be denied or delayed. And it's the notion that when you come into court, There shouldn't be special pleading, favoritism to particular parties and the like. And I think that's a very remote ancestor, if you like, of the Equal Protection Clause. And I'm fascinated by how, as you rightly point out, how due process and equal protection have really been intertwined. And due process, which you might think of as being individualistic in the sense of, you know, the treatment of one person, has powerful egalitarian or equality implications about it. For example, in American state courts, between the time of the Constitution and the 14th Amendment, 1868, there are scores of cases in which state courts use the due process clause of state constitutions to do the kinds of things today you would frame in equal protection terms. Since there was no equal protection clause, but equality issues were on the table, courts used the due process clause to do that. You will find American Supreme Court cases, even modern cases, in which due process and equal protection intertwine. For example, Justice Black, in a case from California involving whether indigents were entitled to have transcripts on appeal if they couldn't afford to buy one, must the state provide one? And he very carefully, I think quite consciously, positions grounded that case in a combination of due process and equal protection. Even textually, he did that. And of course, you can find any number of cases. The Warren Court famously exploded the Equal Protection Clause in lots of directions. So I think the story of due process and equal protection are intertwined, which I think you're suggesting. And I think it does have roots in one way or another in not so much Magna Carta itself, but as the English common law developed. I think by the time we had a constitution, those two ideas were very much cousins. Secondly, on affirmative obligations, that's a fascinating issue to put on the table because that's in constitutional theory terms, that's a very modern idea. The first national constitution I can think of that had explicit affirmative rights was the Mexican Constitution of 1917. The first European constitution to have affirmative rights was the Weimar Republic Constitution of 1919. And then, of course, it spread to the point where it is hard to find a constitution today anywhere in the world other than ours that doesn't, in its text, give you a list of affirmative rights. Now, this opens up problems that we can't really take very far today, but the problem of how do you give meaning to those rights, how do you execute them, how do you give a judicial remedy? I understand what a judge can do if I say my rights of free speech are being violated by the government. I can ask for an injunction or damages. If the Constitution says there's a right to a job and there just aren't enough jobs to go around, it's a little harder to see what a judge does about that. Does he tell the Congress or the legislature to give me a job? Fraternity is the one that's really challenging because, as you know, as you point out in the French Constitution, you have the concepts of liberty, equality, and fraternity. My sense is that's a product of French political thought, Jean-Jacques Rousseau in particular, his idea of the general will, something you really don't find in Anglo-Saxon or Anglo-American constitutional law. And it's frankly an elusive concept. When Rousseau envisioned the social compact, he had this notion of the general will to which each person gave their allegiance. There's that famous and somewhat chilling phrase in the social compact where Rousseau says, one must be forced to be free. So I think, frankly, in the way it's played out in other places, the idea of fraternity, which seems so innocent and attractive, has actually merged with ideas of the nation. In our culture, when we talk about the nation, we simply mean the United States. When Europeans talk about the nation, they're more likely to be talking about an ethnic or national or religious or linguistic, a tribal kind of sense. The Turkish Constitution, for example, 1927, Ataturk's Constitution, really is setting out to reinforce the idea of being Turkish. And there's no place in that constitution for any national minorities. The Kurds don't exist. The Armenians, we know what happened to Armenians. The Greeks were sent back to Greece. The Kurds were still in the mountain. Turks called them mountain Turks, but they were Kurds. And that is, that first Turkish, modern Turkish constitution has French handprints all over it. It really is clearly designed by people who knew French political thought. So I think I have a little bit of discomfort about trying to import into constitutional terms what I take to be the idea of fraternity. Short answer is and not sufficient answers to some very interesting questions.
And now you're going to get some more.
And I'll get some more.
So since Professor Hermanstedt, I will stand as well. Professor Howard, my questions are going to be far more disjointed, and they're really random questions, and I explained to Professor Howard right before, I'm not a historian, not even close. But I am curious, and hopefully my questions will, I don't know, help us think about the Magna Carta and why it matters. Which really goes to my first question, because I'm still not convinced by how much the Magna Carta matters. Okay. So what my real question is, should we celebrate the Magna Carta for what it says, for its actual words, or is it really simply the idea behind it, the idea that the barons were able to force King John literally to the table in a way they'd never been able to force a king, and obviously something that the founding fathers would appreciate, the idea of sort of forcing sort of King George to sort of bend. So is it that idea that we're really celebrating, or is it the words themselves? And one reason why I question whether it's the words themselves, if it's the words, do we mean the words from the Magna Carta of 1215, or the Magna Carta of 1217, or the Magna Carta of 1224. My understanding is the original Magna Carta had 63 chapters. Eventually, that was whittled down to, I think, about 3.5 that matter. So what words, if it's the words, should we care about, or is it really the symbolism? The other reason I question whether it's the words that matter is, if it's the words that matter, then why are we singling out the Magna Carta and not also including in the same conversation, giving equal weight to the Petition of Rights, the Habeas Corpus Act, the English Bill of Rights, and the Act of Settlement? It seems like so much of what we have in the Bill of Rights came from those documents, and yet everything seems to be about the Magna Carta. So that's really my first question. Is it the Magna Carta symbol, idea? Or words.
Shall we respond to them as?
Yes.
Well, I think that makes perfect sense. It's a lovely question. It's implicit in this whole program. And I think if this were a group, if we were gathered to talk about the text of Magna Carta, I think it'd be a different audience. Most of you wouldn't be here, I suspect. This would be an antiquarian search for the parsing of the language of Magna Carta itself. I mean, it'd be an interesting conference, but it would be people, medievalists for the most part of.
Now,
Scootage, that's right. We'd be talking about fish weirs on the Medway in the Thames and some other wonderful, wonderfully arcane ideas. Remember, this is not responsive to the question, but the words of Magna Carta were in Latin to begin with. So if we had to conduct this conference in Latin again, I think the audience would be diminished and I would not be at the table. I would not wish to conduct the discussion in Latin. But talking about the words, I think I was trying to argue in my opening remarks that as interesting as what Magna Carta itself said, in a few weeks it was dead. It had been overruled nullified by the Pope on behalf of King John. And so I think the reason we talk about Magna Carta today is only partially the language itself, but much more so, and you've really implied this in your question, the whole idea that you could bring a 13th century king to the bargaining table and in some ways try to trim his prerogatives. That the symbolism of that surely would be powerful. And I think then the language, the words are important in the sense that they weren't conservative. The barons would like you to think that they had come to present these demands as being ancient right, that they weren't simply in making them up as new demands on the king. Well, there was a bit of special pleading, I think, in that. But they had a notion that if you search back into ancient, long before 1215, you discover this golden age when everybody understood that there were limits on royal authority. And that is really very much part of the Anglo-American story, that we'd like to think that we're advancing an argument for which there is long-standing precedent, that surely anybody who thinks about it must understand that this is not something that sprang from your own personal imagination. So I think you have in the symbolism of the act of Magna Carta, but also the notion that these are ideas that are thought to be, in effect, part of the birthright of Englishmen. There was a provision in Magna Carta, not clear how many people would benefit from it, but a provision that said, in effect, that the promises the king was making to the barons, they should recognize rights on behalf of people below them. There was the potential of expansion there. I think ultimately the reason Magna Carta mattered was not what it meant at Runnymede in 1215, as important as that was, but what later uses people made of it. In this sense, your question overlaps with the first question about equality. Namely, it's not a matter of what the Equal Protection Clause meant in 1868, as important as that was. It, in the hands of the Warren Court in the 1960s, it did all manner of things. One person, one vote, school desegregation, criminal justice and procedure and the like. And similarly, I tried to tell the story of how Cook in the 17th century, how James Otis in the 18th century, how other people really painted a picture of Magna Carta outstripping what it meant at the time. I mean, they were using it in ways that surely went beyond habeas corpus, trial by jury. These things weren't in Magna Carta, but people believed that they were, and that belief is what finally came to matter.
Which actually relates to sort of a follow-up question I had, because it seems to me one way to understand the sort of the chain from the Magna Carta, the thread from the Magna Carta to American jurisprudence is it's been a series of misreadings of the Magna Carta, but it's worked to the benefit of Americans, that we've misread it. We've misread into it a right to a jury trial that wasn't there. We've misread into it sort of, you know, the foundation for equality that wasn't in the original document. Would you agree?
I think that's right. I mean, I see so much parallel between the Americans in the Age of Revolution made of Magna Carta in their arguments against the Crown and Parliament, and the ways that modern people, the Supreme Court and other people, have used the Due Process and Equal Protection Clauses of the 14th Amendment. And some would say those are misreadings, that that's illegitimate to import into the 14th Amendment ideas that were not in the minds of the Congress in 1868. But Brown versus Board of Education famously says we can't turn the clock back to 1868. And it's not enough to show that Congress in 1868 in approving the 14th Amendment appropriated money for segregated schools in the District of Columbia. Okay, so they did, but that doesn't keep us from saying the profound truth of something like equal protection means the states can't segregate in public education. And so I wouldn't quite want to call it a misreading. I'd call it a constructive reading, if you like, that we've taken an idea, built on it, used it in ways that really respond to the needs of our own generation.
Okay. So I think I just have two more questions. I think they'll be brief. The first one is very brief, and it might seem like a silly question, but I can't get it out of my head. So does the Queen of England celebrate the Magna Carta, and if so, why?
Well, she was there.
Yeah, she was there, and why?
I mean,
did she look happy?
She was at, they had a wonderful ceremony at Runnymede on June the 15th this year, and there she was with Prince Philip and the Princess Royal and Prince William and everybody else, and I have to confess I feel kind of churlish about the occasion. I thought I was going to have a seat next to the Queen. David Cameron took that seat. And I just thought maybe I shouldn't make a great public point of it. But now, I mean, it's sort of like, how does she feel each time she reads the speech opening Parliament and she lays out the government's program, and it may be conservative, it may be labor, it may be something else. How does she feel about those things? She's not saying, is she?
Yeah.
So I think that your question wants me to get inside the mind of the Queen, and I'm not going there.
And I guess my final question is this. It's another sort of easy question, or relatively easy. But I can't help but wonder, especially looking around today, for a lot of young people in this country, when they think Magna Carta, they probably think of an album by Jay-Z. So how do we make the Magna Carta relevant to young people? And I guess I'll include in that young lawyers, but it goes beyond young lawyers, really just young people in general.
Yeah, I would love, that's the one. Of course, I always get a bit nervous when I'm in a classroom or in a public setting like this, and somebody says, I have an easy question for you. It makes my blood run cold because I know something heavy is about to be dropped on me. But this is a wonderful way, I know we're moving towards our conclusion, a wonderful way to sort of pull all this together is, okay, there are people in the room here, presumably you turned out because you've thought a little bit about Magna Carta, and these ideas interest you, and you are curious to know what this fellow Howard or his colleagues on the panel will have to say about it. But if this were a room full of high school students and the like, I am one, unlike some of my generation, I do not give up on the prospect of reaching the minds and hearts of young people. I really believe in it. I wouldn't be a teacher. Now I'm a teacher at the law school level. Well, that's actually pretty hard work in its own way to reach their minds and hearts. But I remember a few years ago being invited down to Richmond to do a session with a We the People team at one of the public high schools, an urban high school in Richmond, and those people took me apart. I mean, I wish the students in my seminar were as engaged and informed and passionate as these high school kids were about the Constitution. I think my effort to answer your question is that it's no more difficult to get young people to think about Magna Carta than it is to get them to think about the Constitution. That you have the same search of, well, why does it matter in your life and your future when you get a job and raise a family and the like? I mean, it's really all about civic education, and it matters. In the countries I've worked in, I think about South Africa, for example, where when they had their first free election, millions of South Africans went to the polls in that election who had had no formal education, certainly nothing we would call an education. And so they had to explain to them what it meant to vote, what a constitution meant, and all that sort of thing. If it can be done under those circumstances, surely it can be done in this country. And I think, of course, you adapt modern technology, you think of ways. It's sort of like the problem, you ever visit historic houses, Monticello, Mount Vernon, Mount Peter, and the like. In the old days, you'd drag your kids along and they'd take you through one room after another and you'd look at all these artifacts. You don't do that anymore. You know, kids are not willing to do that. So custodians of these historic houses have to invent ways, interactive sort of ways, and like to catch the imagination of young people who visit some of those historic sites. I was just at Jamestown the other day where it's an archaeological dig. What would seem more dreary for a young person than archaeology? Potsherds and that sort of thing, holes in the ground. Well, they discovered four skeletons from the first settlement. They've identified who these four people were, and one of the skeletons had in it a little silver box, and it apparently is a reliquary because it has bones inside. Well, this was an Anglican, this was a Church of England settlement. I mean, there were not meant to be any Catholics at Jamestown. So was one of those leaders of that colony secretly a Catholic? Was he, as some people might surmise, a spy for the Spaniards? You start telling the story that way, it captures the imagination to imagine all the intrigue that goes on in a place like Jamestown. So if you can make graves and archaeology come to life, I think you can make Magna Carta and the Constitution come to life.
Okay.
What a wonderful note to end this fabulous program on. Dick, I am so proud that Professors Herman and Capers worked you over a little bit and were able to throw you a couple of fastballs. You hit them cleanly.
I don't want to see that.
I don't think adequately because I think, you know, our door will be open to a series of lectures, the Dick Howard lectures, or maybe come up and teach a class. A course, not a class. So our door is always open to you, and we love having you here. I can't remember if I sent this to you or not, but 2 weeks ago, there's a law journal leadership issue University of Toledo publishes every 2 years, and I had an article in it narcissistically titled, Dean Grows in Brooklyn. And footnote 20 mentions my appreciation to Dick Howard, among others, because our long friendship has benefited me in many, many ways, including he was one of the people who encouraged me with the audacious thought that I might be able to become a law dean, and I'm very grateful for you for that support and advice along the way. And your approach, not only to teaching, but just your general collegiality and fraternity are things I try to emulate, not as successfully as you are. So I'm personally very grateful to you. This is quite a program. I must say, Professor Herman, that when you're talking about the U.S. Constitution being one of limitations, for some reason, at least three counterexamples popped into my mind. One was the Necessary and Proper Clause, where Congress is given power in Section 1, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 18, the power to do what it's supposed to do, and then they list those things, and implying that you not only have specific responsibilities, but that you're given the power to do it, and then, of course, those two mysterious amendments in the Bill of Rights, 9 and 10. Now, it takes a little bit of Jesuitical backflip jujitsu to get there to make the argument I'm going to make, but if the states reserve powers that aren't enumerated, that may mean that the federal government is obliged to make sure that the states have those powers and it can't be taken away. It's a little bit of a flip-flop. And then Article 10, which seems to me to be somewhat redundant in some respects, but then powers that aren't delegated to the government remain in the people and the states, and I think you can make a similar argument. So it's not it has evolved from the very much narrower Magna Carta point, I think. Today, you might ask a question, why are we doing this? Why is Brooklyn Law School the center of such a day-long program? First, because we can, and it's a marvelous thing, and we were able to attract such wonderful different types of presentations. It was worthwhile. But I think that from Derek Taylor at the beginning to the panel of very distinguished librarians, I see Janet is here, my friend from Merton College is here, Dr. Walworth, and there may be some others. The lunch presentation was fabulous and was a wonderful exchange between our faculty members and Michael Pinto Duchensky. He covered a lot of ground in his talk, even though a couple of pages were missing from his presentation. I'll keep teasing you about that. And the cyber panel was the most heavily attended session, and I'm told there were thousands of people following it online, so go figure. And isn't it ironic that the most technical snafus happened with the cyber law panel? It was just Murphy's Law, I guess, right? And for me, a very, very special moment was having Hugh Locke here, who's sitting in the back. I don't know, you were at Runnymede when his sculpture, The 12 Jurors, was dedicated, and you may not have seen him coming in at different times, but he's here, and we'll get a chance to talk to him a little bit later. And then, of course, I'd say it's the icing on the cake, but there was a lot of cake in your presentation, and we really appreciate that. What a wonderful day. So the reason to go through that all is, I think through that program today, we certainly got a phrase from Derek's book, the golden thread of truth about Magna Carta, starting to discern the difference between myths and realities and answer questions like Professor Caper posed about, you know, is it actually the words, or why does it matter, and, you know, is it really what it's become or what we think it's become? But I think we not only began to get an answer about what it is, but why we're asking these questions. And why we're asking these questions at this law school, and why it's very appropriate for us to be so presumptuous here on 250 Joralemon Street in Brooklyn, New York, is because what this law school gets, as much as any law school, but what this law school really gets is that what we do, and I'm looking out at our world-class faculty, and what we do here really matters and makes a difference. We need more lawyers now who are prepared to meet tomorrow's challenges, and it really matters. And that is why, if you put it all together, that this school has been doing so many things with respect to access to justice for others, the affordability of legal education, improving the program to make it more vibrant and more rigorous and useful, fighting the bar exam as it's presently structured as being unfair and exclusive. All of these things which are, in a way, shortchanging the public of qualified new lawyers to be champions and to answer questions like we're answering, but to be champions to advance the cause of justice under law and due process for all, and the four freedoms, which, you know, there's a wonderful park on Roosevelt Island, which now is Four Freedoms Park, and it commemorates FDR. It was 70 years when that the Four Freedoms were officially, with Eleanor Roosevelt's great assistance, incorporated into a charter for all mankind. So that's why we're at it. That's why this is all related to what we do here. And I'm enormously proud that this community has come together for this purpose today. And I thank everybody, including the audience, that has been so attentive all day long. Thank you very much.